Lord Jesus, we thank you for this word. We ask that you honor it, bless it, and have it to bear fruit. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Love of enemies. That is Jesus' most famous and most violated teaching. Why? Because people are by nature side takers. In families, in church, school, at work, you find the us against them happening. Jesus was radical. Because instead of the common treatment of giving an eye for an eye, he said instead, love your enemies. In other words, love the people on the other side. The other side of your family, the other side in the church, the other side in school, the other side at work. Jesus said, bridge the divide and love the people on the other side. We tend to choose sides. Dr. Seuss was a famous children's author, and he wrote about us versus them in his story about the Sneetches. If you remember the Sneetches. Now, the star-belly Sneetches had bellies with stars, but the plain-belly Sneetches had none upon theirs. Those stars weren't so big, and they weren't really so small. You might think such a thing wouldn't matter at all, but because they had stars, all the star-belly Sneetches would brag, "We're the best kind of Sneetches on the beaches, with their snoots in the air, they would sniff and they'd snort. We have nothing to do with the plain belly sort." And whenever they met some, when they were out walking, they'd hike right past on past them without even talking. And when the star belly children went out to play ball, could a plain belly Sneetch get in the game? Not at all. You only could play if your bellies had stars, and the plain belly children had none upon theirs. And when the star-belly Sneetches had Frankfurter roasts or picnics or parties or marshmallow toast, they'd never invite the plain-belly Sneetches. They left them out in the cold, in the dark, on the beaches. And they kept them away, never let them come near, and that's how they treated them, year after year. Dr. Seuss wrote the Sneetches to highlight the evils of discrimination. No one here considers themselves a bigot, a racist. But whenever we create an us against them mentality in our homes, at work, wherever, we create an atmosphere of judgment, intolerance, and unforgiveness. When we find someone intolerable, what we do is we magnify their faults and their failures, and we minimize their gifts and talents. To help your friends and punish your enemies, that's normal human behavior. In the movie The Godfather, the mafia leader Don Corleone said, "Keep your friends close, but your enemies close." In other words, stay close to the people, so you can always know when they're going to stab you in the back. But Jesus didn't live according to this. He said, "I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, that you may be children of your Father in heaven. He causes his sun to rise on the evil and the good, and sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous." So anger, hurt, bitterness, they come in waves in all of our lives, and all of us struggle with them. We can forgive someone who says, "I'm sorry." But the struggle most of us have is when they say they're sorry with their words, but their actions say, "I am not sorry, and I don't care how you feel." Jesus said in those situations where the person is unrepentant, he says, "Love them anyway." He says, "If you love only those who love you, what reward will you get? Are not even the tax collectors doing that? And if you greet only your own people, what are you doing more than others? Do not even pagans do that?" Jesus' day, people would greet each other by saying, Shalom Alecha, which means peace be with you. Shalom is not just the absence of bad behavior towards someone. It is the determination to have good behavior towards them. In other words, it's not good enough just not to hate them, but we must go further and pray for them and hope for their wholeness and their peace, even though they are acting like our enemy. Jesus never did something without demonstrating it. And he got in his disciples' face about their discrimination, their division, their intolerance, their judgment, their avoidance, and their unforgiveness towards the others in their society. And he did this simply by saying, let's go to the other side. What was the other side? It was both a geographic location and a cultural abomination. It was Jesus saying, let's go into the red light district, boys. Let's go into the ghetto. And there was no place worse for them to go than what was called the Decapolis, the 10 cities. And because the people there, they lived and they worshiped temples dedicated to sexual depravity, child sacrifice, everything that was abhorrent to a Jew. And moreover, pigs, the most unclean animal to a Jew, was not only eaten in these 10 cities, the Decapolis, they were considered sacred, and they were often used as sacrifices to their gods. The Jews were disgusted by these people, but Jesus said, let's go to the other side. Let's turn to Mark 5, the Gospel of Mark, chapter 5. And we're going to read verses 1 through 20. I'm going to read from the Message. Mark 5, 1 through 21. And this is Jesus and his disciples, his bewildered disciples, going to the Decapolis, to a city in the Decapolis called the Gerasenes. And it says in Mark 5, 1, they arrived on the other side of the sea in the country of the Gerasenes. Very significant that you understand they're in a pagan land. As Jesus got out of the boat, a madman from the cemetery came up to him. He lived there among the tombs and graves, and no one could restrain him. He couldn't be chained, couldn't be tied down. He had been tied up many times with chains and ropes, but he broke the chains and snapped the ropes. No one was strong enough to tame him. Night and day, he roamed through the graves and the hills, screaming out and slashing himself with sharp stones. And when he saw Jesus a long way off, he ran and bowed and worshiped before him, then bellowed in protest, what business do you have, Jesus, son of the high God, messing with me? I swear to God, don't give me a hard time. Jesus has just commanded the tormenting evil spirit, out, get out of the man. And Jesus asked him, tell me your name. And he replied, my name is Mob. I'm a rioting mob. In other translations, it'll say, my name is Legion. Then he desperately begged Jesus not to banish them from the country. And a large herd of pigs, remember they kept pigs, not only to eat them, but to also sacrifice them to their gods. A large herd of pigs was browsing and rooting on a nearby hill. And the demons begged him, send us to the pigs so we can live in them. And Jesus gave the order. But it was even worse for the pigs than for the men. Crazed, they stampeded over a cliff into the sea and drowned. Those tending the pigs were scared to death. They bolted and told their story in town and country. Everyone went to see what had happened. They came up to Jesus and saw the madman sitting there, wearing decent clothing and making sense. No longer a walking madhouse of a man. And those who had seen it told the others what had happened to the demon-possessed man and the pigs. Understand, Jesus is demonstrating his power to these people, not only on this man who was out of his mind, but also on what they used to worship. At first, they were in awe, and then they were upset, upset over those drowned sacrificial pigs, worried about their God. They demanded that Jesus leave and not come back. And as Jesus was getting into the boat, the demon-delivered man begging to go alone, but he wouldn't let him. Jesus said, "Go home to the Decapolis, to your own people. Tell them your story, what the Master did, and how he had mercy on you." The man went back and began to preach in the 10 town areas about what Jesus had done for him. He was the talk of the town. Question. Why did Jesus go to the other side? Yes, they were the ones that needed him. But why did he go to them? What was he trying to demonstrate to his people, his followers, the us's back then?
It's time to break tradition.
Time to break tradition. More.
His love for all.
Thank you. His love for all, yes?
I embody him. Other religions.
I'm God even when I face other religions. And I have mercy on whom I will have
mercy
on. I'm not just the God of the thank you. I am God of all. There's no us and them in Jesus. Not in other religions, not in the world, not in your home, not in your school, not at your work. There's no us and them in Jesus. Where Jesus is concerned, there is no other side. Usually in the middle of a conflict, the other people around you may be trying to see, well, wait, let me look at everything. And you might say, "Oh, wait a minute, whose side are you exactly? Whose side are you on?" And you can tell them, "I understand that's where you're coming from, but I'm really only on Jesus' side. Through God's eyes. I love you. And we ace cool boo. But not everything I do is right. So how can everything you do is right? Do you understand that? But you know what? God knows what everything is right. God knows everything. On your side. But guess what? He's also on the other person's side. That doesn't mean both of you are right. It just means that God wants the best for both. Amen, church.
Amen.
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 I know it's hard to express goodness and kindness to someone who has hurt you. I know it's hard. I never stand before you as a paragon. Never. I'm always someone who dips in there and the Lord says, "Look at you, Florida." Always. Always. But when he shows you what he shows you, it is your responsibility to respond. And God says, "I am just as much for their wholeness and their peace as I am for yours. So you got to do what I'm telling you to do." And he may begin to tell you to start, first of all, don't close your heart off. Because that's your natural instinct, which is, not that it's wrong, but it's not for the best. If there's going to be healing at work, at home, in the family, in the generations, you got to do it God's way. So, there's somebody who has offended you, who has hurt you, and this word is coming at you, and you're like, but I have a right. Yes, you have a right to feel what you feel. I'm not telling you to deny what you feel. But is what you feel your goal for this relationship? Because if you continue with the us against them, and you want everybody in your world to choose us against them, then all you're going to do is continue the hurt, the generational curse, the thing that follows you wherever you go. And know this, it's not hard. That's why Christianity is a maturing religion. Because you can do surface and just stay surface. But God knows your heart. And He never calls us to just stay surface. He's always calling deep to deep. So you start expressing kindness. You don't close your heart off to whoever has offended you. And know this, even when you start to express kindness and you let the person know, I'm not gonna let this stand in the way of our relationship, they may not at first be receptive to you. Especially if there's a long-standing something between you. Look back at Mark 5, 14 to 17. The people tending those sacrificial pigs, first they went out and told about the man's deliverance. And when the people came back to see what had happened, they saw this crazy man who had always been crazy, but now he's dressed in his right mind. But they didn't respond to that miracle with joy. They now knew that Jesus had the power to heal and set things right. And you'd think they would then begin to bring their sick and disabled people for Jesus to heal, but they didn't. What they did was they begged Jesus to leave them alone and go away. Why?
They weren't changed.
They were not changed. Also, he was from the other side. Thank you, Asher. He was from the other side. In other words, there was no trust built up. A miracle had been performed, but no trust had been built up. We can't pray for miracles to happen where there has been repeated offense and hurt, and offense and hurt, and offense and hurt. And yes, we can pray that there will be a change there, but there also has to be trust built up. The Jews have rejected these people for generations. And even though they saw Jesus come in here, care about them, do something that was totally miraculous, there was no history of healness and wholeness and peace and trust. There was only history of hurt and rejection. And that was greater than what they saw happening in front of them. So what did Jesus do? He didn't force himself upon them. He gave them space. He left them. But he left in their midst a testimony of his goodness. Who did he leave? Asher. He left the man. He said, go back. Go back to your country and tell them what I did for you. Isn't he a great guy?
Yes, he is.
So there are a lot of learning curves here. There was the bewildered disciples. Why are we in this disgusting place? These disgusting people. And there were the bewildered people in the town. Why would a Jew come here? And why would they heal a person nobody could heal? Nothing could heal. Why? And then this man goes out and starts telling them what God has done for him. That God had favor on him. The God of the Jews had favor on him. And the people were amazed. Folks, transformation doesn't happen always immediately. Sometimes it takes time. But there was a different effect. Because Jesus returned back to the cities of the Decapolis. A short time later, when he came back, the people saw him and they ran towards him, bringing their sick and laying them at his feet. And wherever he went, in their towns and villages, they begged Jesus to touch them and heal them. And they had no more reservations because they knew God was for them. Those on the other side. Jesus taught his disciples how important the others were. And you know what he did? He fed them. You just got to get this. I just love the word. I just love the word of God. Twice the Gospels record a massive feeding of several thousand people. And you might have said, are these the same? Is this the same feeding? But one says it was a feeding of 5,000 in Mark 6. And then later in Mark 8, there's a recording of the feeding of the 4,000. What's the difference? Isn't it the same miraculous feeding? It's not! It's not! And you guess why the significance of this is? The feeding of the 5,000 was the feeding of the Jews. And the feeding of the 4,000 was the feeding of the Gentiles. Isn't that awesome?
It's awesome.
Yeah. Guys, isn't that awesome?
Yes, amen.
Hallelujah. The disciples were shocked that he would do this. Not only for the Jews, but also for the Gentiles. He provided for both the us and them. Grace was for us and them. Power was for us and them. Provision was for us and them. God loves the world. He died for the world. He wants the best for you and for them. So when there's division and intolerance anywhere in your world, know that Jesus is on your side and he's on their side. Jesus is for all sides. He doesn't just love us, he loves us all. So how does that make you feel, knowing that Jesus wants the best for your enemies? You can give an answer.
It makes you feel that Jesus must be a very big, merciful God.
Amen.
Because he's got what everybody needs, not just me.
Yes. He's got it all. And he can see further down. Guys, he knows who needs to be in your life. that you may think right now, I don't need this person. This person is nothing but damage to me. This person complicates my world. This person just does nothing but just bring problems. A lot of times the problems in our world simply bring up our intolerance and our lack of patience and our lack of prayer and our anger. And God is saying, I want you to deal with that inside stuff that this person brings out with you. Some of us don't want other people to be blessed in our world because they're on the other side. This simply goes back to unforgiveness. That is the root of it all. We're struggling to forgive them for an offense or offenses from the past. So think about the people on the other side in your life. Some of you may have trouble with that. You may say, I don't have a single soul in my world that I have a problem with. There's no us in my world. And I say to you, go and sin no more. Everybody got an us. You may not be actively engaged with them, but you could be fine if you don't see them in the next 6 months or a year. You're fine. You know? There's somebody. Even if it's not a now, it was a then. I had a then. It was my dad that I told many of you about. For those of you who don't know, who are guests here, my dad struggled with drug addiction. And that meant he was a neglectful parent. Very few drug addicts have good parenting skills. Thank you, I'm glowing, I know. You may know some drug addicts who are great parents, who get their kids up and dress them and help them with their homework and know their teachers and take them to school on time and make sure that they do what they're supposed to do and who are involved in their lives and get them to all their appointments. And you may know some drug addicts like that. There was no drug addict like that in my world. My dad was not an evil parent. He was simply an uninvolved parent because he was self-involved with his drugs. And when I became a believer, I thought it was okay to create this hole that my dad lived in and worship God. Dad was in the hole called anger and resentment and hurt and unforgiveness. And all the while I'm growing as a believer, because I'm looking at my knowledge of the word, my outreaches, how I love worship. I'm looking at how other people respond to me in the church world. I'm looking at lots of things. But I never look at that hole I put my dad in. Because he deserved to be in that hole. That was my thinking. He deserves to be in that hole. And even when I would hear things like, forgive, I thought that was for me. Not for him, because there's no forgiveness for him. He is a hot mess. And he does not deserve anything. He is. So I was his judge and his jury, and I continuously condemned him. And the result was, I could see no right in this man. Nothing he did. Even if he told a cool joke, because my dad loved to laugh, I thought it was a stupid joke. Just because he said it. He would try to joke with me. You know, he would see how angry I was with him all the time. And he would have the nerve to try to get me to laugh. How can you get me to laugh when you didn't show up for my third grade, whatever, whatever? So I held on to my bitterness against this man for being an uninvolved, neglectful parent. And I lost out on a relationship. Folks, you can have a relationship with an imperfect person. Newsflash. Because you know what? God has a relationship with an imperfect person.
Amen.
Guess who that is? Moi. He has a relationship with an imperfect person. All y'all imperfect person. We the imperfect people. And he has a relationship with us. So you can have a relationship with the imperfect people in your world. Because nobody in here is a paragon. Only Jesus. I'm not saying not have boundaries. I'm not saying open your world up for craziness. I'm simply saying not everybody who is imperfect in your world should be in the deep dark hole called condemnation, judgment, unforgiveness, bitterness, and resentment. I've always told you there's good, bad, and ugly in everybody. And when I wall myself off to people's badness, I also wall myself off to people's goodness. And they do have some goodness in them. But if you wall it all off, you won't see nothing in them. They're just collateral damage. Just get away from me. But you know what? There are some people God won't let you get away from. I don't care how much you run. He will let these people still retain a presence in your world. And you keep saying, why won't you release me from this presence? And then God is saying, why won't you release them from this hole you have them in? It's not about them. It's about you and your need to grow up in this area, accept my grace for what happened to you, and go on with your life. And open yourself up to the possibility that there may still be an option for a restored, healed relationship with this imperfect person in your world. And you see, you might have people around you saying, oh no, you should not engage with them again. You know, oh no, they did bad to me, they did bad to you, they just always gonna do bad, and we should never give them any opportunity to show any good whatsoever, because they're just bad, 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 bad. That is not a God. That is not of God. That is you holding on to everything that was ever done to hurt you. And God says, you gotta release that. You gotta release it, folks. Unforgiveness is a relationship killer. It is poison to your soul, and no matter who you love, if you've got a lot of unforgiveness in your world, in your heart, even the people that you love are going to feel that edge of anger and bitterness and resentment. You think that the people around you who know that you have a hard time with so-and-so, that they don't occasionally get it from you? you're intolerant to one person, believe me, you're going to be intolerant to a lot of people in your world. Because it's a poison that seeps into everything. It's going to hinder you, hinder your relationships, even the ones that you just adore. They're going to feel this edge every once in a while come out at you because they're holding on to bitterness and resentment towards somebody else. You got to forgive. You got to allow what the enemy may have put as a foothold in your life. You gotta kill it before it becomes a stronghold. Because when it becomes a stronghold, it has the potential to become generational. And then it just passes down. Amen. Stop helping Satan to torture you. Amen. Be quick to forgive. Have the ability to love the people in your world even more. Because now you're willing to let it go towards that particular person or set of people who did you wrong. Number one, you got to decide to forgive. It's a decision, folks. It's not a feeling. You will never forgive if you wait until you feel like it. The Lord Jesus said, forgive. Love your enemies. So you make a decision. I'm going to forgive. I'm going to love the person who has acted towards me in a hateful way. Because I don't want this bitterness to poison me, to poison the people who I love. And more than anything, I don't want nobody controlling me. Because when you walk around in unforgiveness and resentment, that person is on your mind every single day. You standing in the subway. Ooh, you in the supermarket. Ooh, you know, you at the doctor's appointment. Ooh, you with your kids playing. Ooh, the nerve! And this person is controlling. So you got to decide. And then you got to depend on the Holy Spirit. Some things people have done and said, it's too hard for you to forgive on your own. You got to need the help of God. God, you got to help me with this because this person is driving me crazy. I need your help, Holy Spirit. I surrender, what we say today. I surrender because I can't do this in my own flesh. I need your help. And then you got to obey what the word says, which says, pray for your enemies. Pray that they will make better choices. Pray that they will see God. Pray that you will heal them of the offenses that were done to them that makes them respond the way they do. And ask God to give you wisdom about future ways to relate to that person. How are we on time?
1:20.
The last thing I want to talk to you about once you make the decision to forgive and you're depending on the Holy Spirit and you're obeying what the Word of God says, I want you to all say this sentence: forgiveness is not trust.
Forgiveness is not trust.
Say it again.
Forgiveness is not trust.
Okay. Let me explain. Forgiveness means, you know what? I'm letting it go. Dad, I'm not going to hold it against you that you were too high to read my grades. I'm just not going to hold it against you. But if my father was still alive today, that does not mean that I will automatically trust my whole world to my dad. Because my dad is a drug addict. Was a drug addict. So that means he's not trustworthy. But that doesn't mean that he's bound for hell! There's a difference, folks. He was an imperfect man who had issues and problems. But there are areas I could have related to him. There were times that I could have set a safe boundary to be around him, to still engage with him, with knowledge and wisdom. But I never gave myself those opportunities because he was just bad to the bone. Forgiveness means let it go. It does not mean the person is ready to be trusted again. Every healthy relationship requires boundaries. And they're especially important when there's been a major offense. I was reading about this conversation, Dr. Cloud, he's a Christian therapist. He was having with this lady, and he said in the conversation he was relating how this woman came up to him and said, "I know I'm supposed to forgive, but I just can't open up to that kind of hurt anymore. I know I should forgive him and trust him, but if I let him back in, the same thing will happen, and I'm just not going to go through that again." And Dr. Cloud said, "Who said anything about trusting him? I don't think you should trust him either." And she said, but you said I'm supposed to forgive him. And if I don't do that, doesn't that mean giving him another chance? Don't I have to open up to him again?" And he said, "No, you don't. Forgiveness and trust are two totally different things. In fact, that's part of your problem. Every time he's done this, he comes back, apologizes, and you just accept him right back into your life, and nothing changes, and it just goes round and round and round again. He keeps doing it, and you keep trusting him, and nothing's different, and I don't think that's wise." Well, she said, "Well, how can I forgive him without opening myself up to being hurt again?" And he said, "When people have been hurt, they do one of two things. After an offense has occurred, the other person says sorry, forgiveness is extended, the offended person then opens himself up again to and blindly trusts all over again. Or, afraid of opening up, the offended person refuses to forgive, holds on to the hurt, fearing that forgiveness will make them vulnerable once again. So how do you solve this dilemma?" So write these three sentences down, if you can. Number one, forgiveness is letting go of the past. It's not holding something someone has done against them. It's letting it go. And you only need to just forgive them. And just as God has offered forgiveness to everyone, we're expected to do the same. Okay, I'm going to let it go. I'm not going to let this thing just bind me anymore. But the second thing, reconciliation has to do with hope for the present. When that other person responds to your forgiveness, apologizes for the offense, and accepts your forgiveness, you have reconciled. But you have not yet established a good, boundary, healthy relationship going forward. You simply said, "Okay, you're out of the hole, and the relationship can begin. But it's got to go forward with the B word, boundaries." Not blindly trusting, but boundaries. And that's what you're going to risk going forward. You open yourself up and you say, "Okay, that was then, this is now. Now we're ready to relate, but we're going to relate in a way that's safe for you and safe for me. So in a good boundary relationship, you forgive for the past, you reconcile for the present, and then you set boundaries for the future. You understand?
Yes.
Thank you. Trust should never be automatically given once a person is forgiven. Trust depends on how that person responds to you going forward. Your relationship is now built on trust. Not blind trust. Safe trust. And when something breaks that safe trust, you go back to maybe needing some space. You don't put them back in the hole because you know that doesn't work. But once you've had some space, you go to the Lord. Help me, Jesus. Okay, fill me with grace and mercy and compassion and forgiveness. I can't get this person out of my life and I can't kill them. So help me. We're just going to be in each other's world. But it's got to be healthy. So help me to forgive them. But help me to have good boundaries with them going forward. Because I want a trusting relationship. And communicate that to the other person. Jesus wants you to be willing to relate. But send a clear message about how you're going to relate in the future. And that you will no longer be shamed or hurt by that. That's your condition for continued relationships. The worship team can come up. The benefits of forgiveness. There's increased happiness and good health. Restored positive thoughts. Increased compassion and understanding. Reduced stress, anxiety, depression, and chronic pain. There's a lower risk of alcohol and substance abuse. There's an ability to function better in your career, your education, your work, and your home. And there's hope for the future. Forgiveness releases us from the past, reconciles us to the present, and gives hope for trust in the future. Forgiveness is the best outcome if we want a life well lived. Amen.
Amen.